In episode 5, I talked about time-lapse photography. In this episode, I want to talk about action sequence photography, another type of photography that allows us to observe what would otherwise be impossible to see. As with time-lapse photography, we have to use a tripod and have all the camera settings on manual. But rather than shooting at a very slow shutter speed, we have to shoot at the very highest shutter speed because we want to freeze the action. But before we get started, I want to show you my latest time-lapse videos. I'm really excited because a couple of days ago my son showed me how to add movement to these videos. This is a little stream that runs through West Park. I took 590 pictures taken at 1 second intervals with a 2.5 second exposure. The entire session lasted 30 minutes. As we saw in episode number 5, time-lapse photography takes hundreds or thousands of still images taken from a single location at a specific interval over a long period of time and converts them into a movie. Action sequence photography, on the other hand, merges the images taken during a few seconds of an object as it passes in front of the camera. The number of images depends on the speed of the object and speed of the camera, the number of frames per second that the camera can take. At very high speeds, it's necessary to use a strobe, which flashes many times during a single shot. Once you've taken your pictures, the next step is to decide which and or how many of them you will choose to tell your story. As with time-lapse photography, it's only when we combine the photos that the magic happens. In this sequence of a horse jumping, there are 10 shots. If we eliminate every other picture, we end up with 5, which is much easier to work with and will give us a better result. Now we import the selection into Photoshop, choose which image we are going to use as the background or the main image, and then add a mask to the rest of the pictures. In each of these pictures, we erase the subject from the mask by painting it black, and then we invert the image. The last step is to carefully edit the overlapping areas. In the case of this skater, I chose to include the entire sequence, in spite of the amount of overlapping. Again, it depends on the speed of your subject and the speed of your camera. If the background is not exactly the same in all your pictures, a person walking, a dog running, the leaves on the trees moving in the wind, then you have to eliminate the background in all but one of the shots. In this case, the photographer moved as he followed the skater through the jump, so I chose the background from the third shot. See you in the next episode.